Sampling in qualitative case studies happens at two levels primarily. So one of the things that we know, at least based on Eisenhardt's work from 1989, is that you need 4 to 10 cases in order to have a good qualitative case study. And then what the ideal number is going to depend on how many theoretically valid dimensions you're interested in. I tend to work with 2 dimensions so that I create a matrix, and then I try to have a low high on one end and a low high on another. The amount of time investment on the part of the respondent also means that it's usually difficult to find people who can spend this amount of time. One of the key questions in qualitative case study research is how much data is enough data? And to be able to address this question, we have to enter the territory of sampling and how it works in qualitative case studies. But before we get to that, I would like to spend a bit of time on explaining what qualitative case studies are, when we need them, and therefore how this affects the sampling choices that we are going to make. Qualitative case study methodology is often applied to complex phenomena that we would like to study in their real-world setting. So there are certain elements about the real environment within which these phenomena occur that make them really difficult to understand, or we cannot explore particular aspects of the phenomena in isolation from the context within which they are embedded. They're also relevant for those aspects of reality that are difficult to quantify, or even if we could, we wouldn't understand or know what exactly we should be measuring. So they are often used for exploratory reasons. And this is the type of case study that I'm going to address within this video. Sampling in qualitative case studies happens at 2 levels primarily. The first level relates to the case itself. Which cases are you going to select to be part of your study? And then the second relates to, let's say, if you are collecting primary data, who you are going to interview within those cases, or what sort of data you're going to look for that relates to those cases in particular. To select your cases, you need to understand the unit of analysis first and foremost. So unit of analysis refers to the level at which you would like to analyze a phenomenon. So as an example, I study supply chains, and within supply chains, you will have different organizations, let's say manufacturers, wholesalers, retailers, distributors, and these are considered to be supply chain actors. So it could be that I would like to do a research that focuses on manufacturers in different supply chains. So the unit of analysis becomes a manufacturing firm. And so I will have, if I have 5 manufacturing firms, I have 5 cases. So this is usually the easiest way that you can know what a case is, and you can be able to count how many cases you have got. It's also quite essential, therefore, for determining the level of detail that you are going to be preoccupied with. So if, for example, within a manufacturing plant, there's a subunit or subdivision that you find particularly interesting, it could be that even though there are some fascinating details about that particular part of the manufacturing firm, you shouldn't pay too much attention to it because that's a bit lower than your unit of analysis. There could be compelling reasons to keep them, and there could be ways around that, but that's something that I can address another time. So in order to be able to select your cases, there are no hard rules, but there are certain templates that we tend to work with. So one of the things that we know, at least based on Eisenhardt's work from 1989, and this hasn't been challenged much, is that you need 4 to 10 cases in order to have a good qualitative case study. And how you select these cases also matters, because that's a very small number of cases, or that's a very small sample size compared to quantitative studies. So if you want to be able to theorize from this, then you have to do what we call purposeful sampling. Purposeful sampling means that you are going to select cases based on certain aspects that you know to be theoretically relevant. You want your cases to be varied enough along certain theoretically relevant dimensions. So one of the words that is used a lot in qualitative case studies is polarity of cases. So cases that sit on extreme ends of a spectrum of a particular measure. Let's say, for example, you are interested in knowing the relationship between economic development and state fragility, then you're going to find a case that has low state fragility. So those are the very stable countries. And you might find a country that has very high fragility. So those are the ones that are expected to be extremely unstable. So it means that when you are going to explore these cases, the fact that they are varied in significant ways in terms of what matters from a theoretical viewpoint means that you enhance the chances of you being able to draw generalizable conclusions from your case study. So the first layer of determining the sample size is in terms of the case, at the level of the case. How many cases are you going to choose? 4 to 10 is just about right. In my experience, 4 to 6 works extremely well. Beyond that, it becomes a bit difficult to manage. And then what the ideal number is going to depend on how many theoretically valid dimensions you're interested in. I tend to work with 2 dimensions so that I create a matrix, and then I try to have a low high on one end and a low high on another. So this way, I will usually then create this matrix and populate each quadrant within the matrix with at least 1 case. And then there you have done your job in terms of the selection. You have to ensure that you can theoretically justify these choices and that these cases are varied enough that we can expect that there will be certain unique features that we can then link back to explanations that lead to some kind of theory building or contribution to theory. The next level of selection relates to the respondent. So let's say you are conducting interviews, and within each case, you are going to need to speak to different individuals that are going to provide the information that's going to be the basis of the study and the theory that you're ultimately going to build, or at least the contributions that you will make. So this one is a bit difficult. It varies from field to field. It varies from journal to journal. I think it's difficult to answer what's an ideal number of interviews that you are going to conduct per case. But it can be, for example, that we can all agree that if you have conducted 50 interviews per case, that's a ridiculously rich amount of data. I don't think you should be expecting that you are going to get any complaints about how limited the data is. But in reality, we know that there are multiple restrictions, and the amount of time investment on the part of the respondent also means that it's usually difficult to find people who can spend this amount of time. So the first thing that I would advise is that you check within your field what's considered to be an acceptable number of respondents or interviews per case, and also check with the journals that you are targeting what's the typical number that people actually introduce. I've seen numbers as low as 15 for exploratory research in total. And also, usually they will have some other kind of data that supports the case. So it could be secondary data documents that they also use, and then they complement the two in order to be able to justify the low number of interviews. But the most important consideration when it comes to how many interviews is enough is what we call theoretical saturation. So it could be that you do not set a hard line in terms of the number of interviews that you're going to conduct, but you can actually check with every interview that you conduct whether you are getting any new information. If after conducting a certain number of interviews, you start to see that there is no new information coming through, that you start to get a good sense of what the patterns are, and these look relatively stable and there's nothing new coming out of it, then it's likely that you have reached theoretical saturation, and therefore it makes sense to stop at that point, because there's also always an understanding that there are limited resources that are linked to conducting this type of research, but also you have to make the trade-offs. You can spend more time looking for more respondents, or you can redirect that time to make sure that you're going to conduct a good and thorough analysis that's going to lead to very meaningful insights. So Unfortunately, I don't have a hard number that I can provide in terms of how many interviews are enough. But the rules that I can give you are, first of all, what's a typically accepted number within a particular field or a journal that you are targeting? When have you reached theoretical saturation in terms of your own interviews? And sometimes, what other types of data do you have that can complement or be a supplement to the interview data that you have collected? If you have done these things to a reasonable extent, then you should be fairly confident that the number of interviews that you have conducted is sufficient. I'm Dr. Noni Chiextra. Follow me to find the joy in academic writing and discover your real potential. Happy writing.